And now, ladies and gentlemen,
get ready for a big surprise. Tonight only, DJ Strip.
One, two, three. There I am. We've had a few technical difficulties, but I believe we've pulled it all together by the skin of our ass, right? Oh, can I say ass? Quick question. Ah, see, that's it. Well, first of all, I'd like to welcome everybody who's listening out there. I am DJ Strip, and this is the party you missed. And basically what my show will be about is my adventures in DJing and babysitting. No, not babysitting, but definitely DJing and places I've opened, places I've been involved with the opening, or places I was just lucky enough to get into and hang out. And I'd like to say what's up to Curly. She's out there in Germany. What's up, girl? Auf Wiedersehen, is that it? Something like that. I don't know. I'm all wrong. But, but check this out. I would like, if anyone would like to call in, today's topic, just so everyone knows, is 1987, integral year. Amazing year, actually. Heavy transition musically in the nightclubs. If you knew what was going on the radio in 87, you probably want to kill yourself. And couldn't be far from what was going on in the nightclubs with the whole house movement in Chicago. And as well as, you know, the New York scene that was picking up on it. I was lucky enough. I was part of like three scenes. I was in the punk scene. I was in the new wave scene. And I was also very into the dance scene because I was always a dancer from when I was a kid. A lot of people don't know that about me. So I was very fortunate to be able to cross over those worlds. Whereas back in the day, if you were a rock and roller, you stayed in rock clubs. If you were a punk rocker, you stayed in punk clubs. Most people didn't do that. And I was very fortunate. At the time, I was in the prescription, or I should say non-prescription drug business. So I had clients in all realms. And that was survival for me. But it is what it is, and I want to start out with a track. I will be playing music. Trust me, I will not just be bullshitting away, because I know that gets boring real fast. But again, I'd like to give a shout-out to my listeners. I know we got Argentina in the house. Liliana, what's up, girl? Got, I believe, my cousin Dick Boy, Dick Anthony. I think he's leaving for Florida, though, so God bless him. And my PR man, Bruce Lynn, is going to give us a call. He's a character, and he's going to tell you why he represents me. Nobody really knows, but he's doing a great job, and I really appreciate it. But listen, call in, 347-725. Is that a 5 or an S? 3-4. We should do it like the old-style phone, you know, K9 Jefferson 212. 347-725-4163 is the number. If you want to call in, share a story, talking shit, 1987 is the topic. And I'm going to start out with this first track because this is something that's kind of part of my old new wave slash punk days. I used to hang out at a lot of really cool clubs on Long Island because back in the day, let me tell you, Long Island had a killer, killer new wave punk scene. And I know my man, let's see, Philippe, I believe he's listening. He's somewhere in a warm part of the world. He said he was going to tune in. He used to own this really cool club called Paris, New York. A lot of people don't know about that, but people who do know, my man Dave Slave, I used to call him Dave No Shave. He was the DJ there. And this is just a great track by one of my all-time favorite bands. And we're going to do a little Joy Division with Transmission. You're listening to Newtown Radio, DJ Strip, the party you missed.
And now, more of DJ Strip.
Transmission. cool your... Your pants down for DJ Strip.
That's right. We're back. That's one of my all-time favorite tracks. I know that goes out to my man Popeye. I know he digs that. That was always his stuff, man. He was always down with, Joy Division, Killing Joke, all those great bands. You know, that's the thing about the 80s, too. What people don't realize is at any given time, you could go to any nightclub within a 10-block region and hear 10 different styles of music, see 10 styles of looks and hair, and, you know, it was just wild. It was a whole different thing. We're talking pre-cell phones, baby. We're talking back in the day where everything wasn't pre-packaged, processed mindset. You know what I mean? It was all on the fly. Nobody knew where anyone was going, pretty much. If you saw somebody the week before, you'd be like, oh, yeah, I'm going to go to this joint, man. And, all right, if you ran into them, you ran into them. If you didn't, you didn't. It was pretty awesome, too, like, because, you know, sometimes you'd see a hot girl and, you know, the girl would be like... You know, you do. These guys in the studio are messing with me. I love it. But you know what I'm saying. So you'd see a girl, beautiful girl, and, you know, maybe you just didn't get up the balls to talk to her, and you'd hope the next week she'd show up, and of course she never did. But, you know, and then, of course, you'd start dating some other girl, and then she'd show up like 3 weeks later. And that was a good dilemma, though. I didn't mind that. It wasn't such a problem. But, you know, again, getting back, you know, with the music... You know, there's a lot of cool stuff, personally, that I really enjoy. And this one here, I'm going to throw this one out. Like I said, I want to throw some music out there right away so you get the idea of the show. You know, back in the day, this female performer, who is one of my favorites, very underrated. And, you know, she just had an incredible style, what she did. And I saw her perform a couple times in some, like, cheesy roller rinks, because that's what people used to do back in the day. Because nightclubs really weren't set up for live performance. And I remember going to this club out on Long Island called Channel 80. And I don't know if you know, my man in the studio, he knows Channel 80. See, now, this was a little more upscale, a little more Guido, you know, the Trans Ams, the Camaros, you know, the 280Z scene, you know what I mean? You know, the cuisine scene, but it was cool, actually, because the girls, let me tell you, the best-looking girls, two types of clubs the best-looking girls are in, Guido clubs and gay clubs. And if you don't know this, well, I don't know what to tell you. Now you do, but that's the deal. I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm a rock and roller, I love punk rock, but them girls, man, you got to dip them like fucking something, some heavy solution before you take them home. You know, whereas them Guido girls, man, they were polished head to toe. They look good, man. They smelled great. Like strippers, you know. Strippers have the best, yeah, like my man said, the hairspray. That's why they wore so much perfume, to cover up the smell of the Aquanet. That's what it was. But I got to tell you, there was this, and I met this female singer who I'm going to say who it is, but, and this track was hot, let me tell you, and it was actually hot prior to 87, but let me tell you, it was still going strong in the Guido clubs. It was a big hit. This is like pre-Madonna. Madonna ripped this girl off totally, wishes she could have sounded like her, but you know how it goes in the biz. There's always the pioneer, they get the credit, and then the follow-up gets the cash. Well, here's a pioneer of the dance club scene. This is Alicia with Too Turned On.
killing me. You're killing me.
Is that your perfume, or you do smell like that always?
You're killing me.
Is that your perfume, or you do smell like that always?
FYI, Larry Levan mixed this track for her. Larry Levan was a DJ that inspired me to do what I do. God rest his soul. We love you, Larry.
The simple art of dancing always involves a DJ like DJ Strip.
The simple art of dancing always involves a DJ like DJ Strip. And now, back to more DJ Strip. The DJ you don't have to be on three hits to enjoy. Back to more DJ Strip, the DJ you don't have to be on three hits to enjoy.
That's right, baby. No three hits needed here. We are back. Newtown Radio. I'd like to thank all the people out there that are listening. New listeners, old listeners, in-betweens, newbies, new jacks, whatever you want to call them. I am DJ Strip, live from Bushwick, baby. DeWick, kid. Get a late pass. You've been missing out. You are listening to The Party You Missed with DJ Strip. The year we are revisiting, 1987. An incredible year for music, especially for the club scene. I don't know what scene you were into. Like I said, myself, I was kind of all over the place. I liked a little bit of everything. I like disco. I like rock and roll. I like house, which was like a real hot new form of disco, per se. I love hip-hop, rock and roll. You know, I was into it all. So, you know, for me, it was, El Guapo said in Three Amigos, I had a plethora of choices. And for those like Hefe who don't know what plethora means, it means I had numerous choices, multi-choice. It was awesome. I could literally, in the course of one night, go to five different completely different venues, punk, disco, new wave, house, hip-hop, even reggae. I mean, and it was dangerous, the reggae clubs, anybody out there who remembers. In New York City in the 80s in general was dangerous. But there used to be this one hot party I used to go to. I was probably, besides the guy who owned the place, the only white guy up in it, Sticky Mike's. Anyone who remembers Sticky Mike's, that was the hot reggae joint. They used to do it Sunday nights. And the place they used to do it at was this really cool restaurant that was downtown on Lafayette and West 3rd. It's gone through a million things. Most recently, it was Rehab or Retox or whatever these kids are coming up with names for nightclubs that have to do with being drug dependent or alcoholics and thinking it's funny. But it was actually in a downstairs space with a really low ceiling. And it would be so hot and sticky and sweaty up in this. And it was awesome, though, because the DJs were phenomenal and the girls were beautiful. And the marijuana was wafting throughout the space. You know, back in New York in the 80s, you could pretty much do whatever you wanted to do as long as you didn't kill anyone. See, note to Robert Chambers. But aside from that, you could pretty much do whatever you wanted to do in the 80s. And, you know, it was good times. A lot of wild parties, a lot of drugs. You know, at that time, most people were not moving into Manhattan. They were fleeing the city because of the crack epidemic that was huge. I mean, it hit in like 85, maybe 86, but it was huge by 87. And there were a lot of problems, a lot of issues. So the people that were moving into Manhattan at that time were pretty much either crazy people, models, musicians. It was a lot of homeless people on the street, that's for sure. But you had to have some big-ass balls to be in Manhattan at that time because it was a pretty rough-and-tumble place. But that was, I think, what made going out at night so special. There was always that element of danger. You were always a little afraid for your life. And that's what made it really exciting, I think. And like I said, I was all over the board. So I could be, you know, at a club, like I say, that maybe, was playing some dance. You never knew. So a lot of times I would come across like just some new venue and I would say, hey, what the hell? You know, let me just pop inside. I used to go with a friend of mine named Perry. Perry O'Neill was a really famous door person in New York City, coffee shop, all the big clubs back in the 80s, early 90s. And one night he said, yo, we're going to this thing uptown. And this had to be definitely late 87. So I was like, all right, uptown, no problem. You know, I'm like, I'm with him. He's cool. He was a big dude, too. I mean, he was about 6'5", 220. He was a big, good-looking brother. And he had all the ladies in love and the connections. So we go up to this place uptown, and it turns out that it was a party for this new movie that was coming out. And so all of a sudden we walk in. I didn't know nothing about it. And I see Judd Nelson. I'm like, oh, cool, that's Judd Nelson. He's a pretty cool dude. I had met him before from my man Wass, who is a big doorman in New York. Big shout out to Wass. And so all of a sudden I'm looking around. And I'm like, oh, shit, like there's going to be a live performance. And that's cool. So we get up near the stage, and it turns out that the movie, it was a party for the new movie, New Jack City, with Wesley Snipes and Judd Nelson and Ice-T. And from the soundtrack of that was this group's first big hit, Strong Island Group. Big up to Strong Island. Big up to the South Shore hip-hop scene in the 80s. People have no idea, but a major contribution. And personally, I think this group was the one who really put hip-hop on the map with the street. I'm talking P.E.
Yo, Chuck, what's the move,
Public
man?
Enemy number one, baby.
And now back to DJ Strick.
I said, yo, brother, don't sway, he nice, he knows he's nice, you know what I'm saying? So Chuck, I got a feeling you're turning into a public enemy, man. Now remember that line you was kicking to me on the way out to L.A. Loud to Queens while we was in the car on our way to the shop? Well, yo, right now, kick the bass for them brothers and let them know what goes on.
What goes on? Well,
well,
I can't put it up on the board, another rapper shot down from the mouth.
Where you going? DJ Strip to the house. Get back over here. Get back over here. Say, where you going? Say, where you going?
You try to sell your equipment, but you get no buyers. Cause you'll never hire, you never on flyers. Plus, you and your crew is all I know, he's gonna try it.
Shut your fucking pie hole.
Say, where you going?
And now back to DJ Strip.
That's right, baby. We're back. We're back. P.E. up in it. That's right, kids. Let me tell you. It was a scary time, 1987, uptown. I mean, it was scary downtown, baby, but trust me, uptown, you did not play around. They would take, I knew girls that live uptown that could take you. Let me tell you, we got a little bit of a mic problem, but you know what I'm saying. Times were tough, chicks were rough. Yo, it was not pretty back then. And that's, again, part of the reason what made the nightclub scene so hot, so attractive. You know, I mean, you'd work all week, you survive, you get through it, you'd figure out a way. And, you know, end of the week, you'd be thinking, all right, you know, I only got two nights to do this. Because usually, you know, the hardcore would go out Thursday night. Because back in the day, Thursday night was definitely the hottest night. Right? Right, my man? Miguel, no, he knows. Thursday night was tight. I mean, Monday, that was all about industry, and that was hardcore. You know, but I'll give you a good example. Heartbreak, Monday night. I mean, that was the spot. Let me tell you, if you knew anything about downtown on a Monday night, there were a couple joints. But Heartbreak in the 80s, you could not touch it. And it was the beauty of that space is because they would play disco, they play Jackson 5, they play 50s music, they would mix it all up. It was incredible. So you definitely had to be, you know, definitely a music aficionado to enjoy it and to get off on that scene. But the beauty of that is when you play all styles of music, that's how you bring together all styles of people. Oh, look, we got people calling. Is that maybe Mr. Bruce Lynn, my PR guy? I don't know. Let's see. Miguel's checking it out. Let's see if we got someone. Who's that? We got a caller? Who's calling in? Bruce Lynn, my PR guy. Do you know how to put him through, Miguel? All right, hang on, Bruce. I know you're listening, but you got... No, not Bruce Wayne. No. This is a whole different Bruce. This is... Let me tell you about Bruce Lynn. Bruce Lynn is an amazing character in New York City. Public relations man. He worked with all the great nightclubs in the 80s, and I've been very fortunate enough to have Bruce be a part of my situation. He's been helping me out, getting me a lot of PR. He's gotten me a lot of Page Six items, which I'm very much appreciative about. And we're going to put Bruce through. We're actually just waiting for Tariq to pop back in here, the producer. I think he's out chatting up some fine young ladies in the hallway. But like I said, we're going to definitely have Bruce on. But getting back to what I was saying about, you know, Heartbreak and a lot of clubs like that downtown, that was the beauty of, you know, a lot of times you go in clubs nowadays and the DJ has got his laptop and his pre-programmed mindset and it's a little too clinical. It's a little too technical. You know, they got their tractor program, which automatically mixes the records, just so everyone knows out there. That's right. These guys really are not DJing. Some of them are, but most of them, they can't mix two eggs to make an omelet. Right, Miguel? They can't. They don't know. So they need this digital program that matches the beats. And you know where we come from. That's cheating. That's you know, I could teach my chihuahua to press start on the computer. You got to feel it. You got to live it. It's got to be live. That's what makes the music hot. That's what gets people excited. That's what makes it all come together. Well, I know I got my man Bruce on the line, but I'm going to get to another track because now before I mention my man Larry Levan, right, my inspiration. He was the guy who got me so into it, made me want to DJ professionally because I started when I was very young. I was a DJ in high school, but I never took it seriously because I was having way more fun. Oh, there's my man Tariq. Tariq, I got a caller, and he's going to be pissed. He's been waiting. We're going to see if we can put him through. Bruce, are you there? Bruce Lynn. Bruce? Bruce? Are you there, Bruce? Bruce Lynn. Bruce Lynn on the line.
Hello, Kevin.
Hello, Bruce.
How's it going?
I don't know. Is your laptop broken? You can't even hear the show, can you?
No, I can't.
Bruce. Well, don't worry. The show will be archived, of course. So, you know, in the future when you get your laptop fixed, I'm sure you'll hear the show. I'll send you the link.
How are you today, Bruce?
I am wonderful. I have a friend visiting from Irving, Texas. Is it Irving or Irvin?
What's the difference?
Irving. And we're getting ready to go out after I do this.
Oh, that's awesome. And what's on the agenda for the,
Well, I want to tell everybody to go to the Chelsea Room tonight.
Okay.
This is the club that is underneath the famed Chelsea Hotel where, you know, Sid Vicious died.
Right.
Where all the great poets live. Now, the Chelsea Hotel is in the process of being sold. And it looks like Ian Schrager, who used to own Studio 54 with Steve Rubell, is going to be the new owner.
Beautiful. Well, that's
well,
the old. That's
not
the old.
So good.
That well, but that space used to be. I used to DJ there. That was called Serena at one point.
Yeah, and then it was Star Lounge, and it's had many incarnations.
Yeah, no doubt, no doubt.
But there's a lot of celebrities going there tonight. So, you know, if you're a people watcher, I really suggest you go and mention my name at the door.
Mention Bruce Lynn, PR man to the world.
Thank you.
Bruce is my guy. Bruce and I, we drive each other insane, but we work well together, don't we, Bruce?
Yes, we do. And Kevin spun at my birthday party, my 55th birthday party at Le Cirque.
Just so everyone knows, Bruce, when he says Kevin, for all you out there that only know me as DJ Strip, that's my actual first name. So you kind of blew me up, Bruce, but that's all right because I know I go as both, so that's okay.
All right, well, I feel better. All right, well, anyway,
It's Kevin James Dalton, if you really want to know.
Oh, all right, let's not. It's like apples and oranges.
All right, I like pears and peaches.
All right, whatever. So anyway, Strip spun.
Strip.
So that's good. Strip spun at my birthday party at Le Cirque. And Le Cirque never had a party like this before.
Never.
In the private room upstairs. He had the whole place dancing and rocking.
We had a great time. Who performed, Bruce? Do you remember?
Randy Jones.
Randy Jones, Village People fame.
And it was great. He sang the Mary Tyler Moore song.
Yes, he did.
And he did Happy Birthday, and he did YMCA or one of those songs. It was great.
I believe he's actually listening right now as well, and I'm hoping Randy gives us a call in because I did send him an invite, and he said he'd get a chance. He'd listen in if he wasn't too busy or recovering, whichever may be the case. And who else? Who was that fabulous drag queen who performed?
Oh, Flotilla DeBarge.
Let me tell you, anybody out there listening to me, you want to see a phenomenal performer. Flotilla DeBarge is her name. We'll just call him Shim. But Shim is amazing because that was an incredible performance, rivaling Randy Jones' rendition of Happy Birthday and YMCA. She's amazing. I don't know what she's doing. I want her to call.
Everybody started to join her in on the chorus. And she stopped and she says,
she was so angry with them.
Oh, so funny. She said, stop the music. Stop the music. Now, listen, this is my song, my rendition. I'll tell you when to come.
That's right, Bruce. Well, Bruce, that was an amazing night, and I'm so happy to be working with you. I'm definitely going to get back to the music now, not to cut you off, but I don't want to bore my listeners with us just chit-chatting. So,
can I just say one thing?
Go right ahead, Bruce. Say five things.
If you want to know more about nightlife and PR and what I do, go to RothschildLynnPR.com.
RothschildLynnPR.com. Plug away, baby. Plug. He's got more plugs than the men's club, baby.
Bite your tongue.
listen, that's what she said.
I hope you'll have me on another time so I can talk about Peter Gation.
Of course. I'm going to do... I'm doing it basically the show in two-year, you know, increments. So I'm doing 87 right now. I'm going to do 89, which, of course, will entail all of that. Because, you know, all those big clubs were revving up at that time. You know, 87, the house music scene was kind of still bigger in Chicago and working its way into New York.
Right.
But, you know, it was a bit more on the underground. But by 89, that's definitely something I want to have you in studio, Bruce, not just on the phone.
Well, I would like that.
All right. Well, it's a real easy ride to Bushwick. Don't worry. We'll give you an armed guard.
You're an amazing DJ. I mean, every time I've seen you spin at Noel Ashman's birthday, at Lucky Strike.
I'm not so bad.
No, you're not.
Not bad for a white boy, right?
Talk to you later.
I love you, Bruce. Again, that's Bruce Lynn, my PR man. He's the best, and I hope he never changes. Oh, yeah. Look, you're getting a round of applause, Bruce. They love you.
Mazel tov on the show.
L'chaim.
L'chaim.
I love you, Bruce.
Bye-bye.
That was Bruce Lynn. He's the best. I'm sure anybody out there who's been a part of New York City over the past 25, maybe 30 years knows who Bruce Lynn is. He's quite the character. Clean and sober, too, I might add, just like my man here. And I'm so proud of you. I'm proud of everyone out there, because if you're listening to this show, chances are you are clean and sober, because you didn't get fucked up all night last night. I woke up with a migraine, and I didn't do anything, so I don't know what my problem is. But check this out. Talking about Bruce Lynn. Now, and like I mentioned before, Mr. Larry Levan. There was a club that very few straight people, or white people like myself for that matter, had the nerve or the luck enough to get into. And that would be Paradise Garage. Now, anybody who knows anything about nightclubs, DJing, house music, I mean, Chicago had it going on, and I will give Chicago. That's the only thing Chicago is good for, except for exporting fat, ugly girls to New York City. But other than that, I'm sure there's a few pretty fat ones, but I think they stay there because they're really into the fat chick thing there. I mean, everyone's eating knockwurst and drinking beer and rooting for the Bears. So, you know what I mean. It's just, it's a Chicago thing. But oddly enough, the house music, though, that came out of there was insane in the membrane. And so I would venture in. I was very fortunate. I think I started going to Paradise in 84. It unfortunately closed in 87, and the reason why I know that, I was a part of the closing ceremony because it actually closed on my birthday weekend when I was 21 years old. So I was finally legal, quote unquote, to drink. But then again, they didn't serve alcohol at Paradise Garage, if you knew anything about that. They only served fruit and water and this and that, because everyone was basically tripping their face off on mushrooms or double barrel purple mesk and all those good treats back in those days, you know. But the music was so phenomenal, and there were certain tracks that used to really make me want to dance, and I have to say this is one of them. So let me drop this on you right now, and if you know anything about the early house music and you were there, and you danced till you sweated your clothes off, it was definitely this track you were doing it to. Again, you're listening to DJ Strip, the party you missed. Newtown Radio.
The simple art of dancing always involves a DJ like DJ Strick.
See, that's why he's a dick, dick, dick.
Don't
turn that dial.
His hands, they move like lightning.
Get over here. You. Hot stuff. I got something for you to listen to.
Right, jack your body, move your body, move your body. That's right, man. Oh man, Steve Still Curly, jack your body. That was the jam. Let me tell you, if you could dance back in the day, it didn't matter. You were white, black, Chinese. You could have been three shades of green. It didn't matter, baby. If you could dance. And you had the nerve and the balls and the moves to get out in the floor. Because back in the, let me tell you, clubs back in the day, when it came to dancing, let me tell you, it wasn't this bullshit like now where you see people kind of standing around, kind of waiting for somebody else to look good. No, 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 no. There was two areas. You had the peripheral, the outer area, where, you know, most people just did their thing with their friends. And then you had the center ring, all right? And if you wanted to be in the sweet spot where the sound was the best, you had to be a good dancer. Because if you got in the middle of the dance floor and you started busting out some nice moves, sure enough, somebody else would step up and want to show their moves off. Right, Miguel? You know what I'm talking about. And that was basically how, you know, you could impress a girl that way or a guy if that's the way you went, you know, or both, you know. Just think about it. If you were bisexual, man, you had it real easy because, you know, if you could dance, man, you had, a plethora of choices of partners. Go ahead, man, Tariq. Hey, listen, talk amongst yourselves. Don't worry about me. Listen, my show is not like some sterile clinical bullshit radio show. We just got some beautiful girl. I don't know who the fuck she is, man, but she just walked in here. I'm happy about that. It's very good because we got enough ugly guys up in here. That quote, we've reached that, all right? But so anyway, like I said, so if you could dance and you were a dancer, you know, you had to come correct. Because, you know, there's just, you didn't mess around on the dance floor in New York City because you basically, I mean, they would laugh you off the dance floor. It's like DJs, too. Back in the day, it was tough. So if you were a DJ, you had to be on point. Every song, like a lot of these DJs now, they'll play one good song. They'll play maybe two good songs. And then they'll drop some whack-ass shit and clear the dance floor. Let me tell you, back in the day, I used to see people get drinks thrown at. People would pull guns. You know, you played the wrong track, man. You fucked up somebody's groove. Listen, I used to DJ Nell's Sunday nights, baby. The blackest. I have black friends who wouldn't go to this party. All right? They were like, you're a crazy white boy. You got no business being up in this shit. And I find you, of course, in the basement, which was a RLA system. Richard Long, anyone who knows anything about sound in New York, he was the man. And he designed an amazing sound system. From the garage. That's right. another garage man who designed incredible sound systems. This was before people even knew what the fuck sound was. This guy literally invented the first digital, not digital, I shouldn't say digital, the first DJ crossover. So you could, you know, take out the mids, take out the highs, drop the bass. I mean, this guy, you know, my man Miguel, he knows what's up, all right? I got Miguel the mime over here, all right? So he's miming out for all you deaf people that you still can't see us, but, you know, we'll get you. We'll get it on video. We got the Skype thing working with Germany. I got Germany checking us out. But, you know, and that's the thing. Like, back then, people would just invent shit for nightclubs, and club owners were open to it. They were cool. They were like, wow, okay, do it, you know? But, you know, you didn't have to go through all the bullshit that everyone goes through now. But I tell you, there was, you know, a magical time, some of these places, and another great track, you know, and this was one of those tracks that it was kind of universal. You could hear it anywhere. Didn't matter. You could be out in some new wave club on Long Island. You could be at even some, like, punk crossover club in Manhattan. And I'd like to drop this one for everyone listening out there. Again, big up to my peeps out on Strong Island, Paris, New York, Spies, The Loop, 007, Thrush. That's right, I didn't forget you. This goes out to my man, Herbie. I think Herbie's listening to us in Huntington, Paris, New York, man. Let's do this. Art of Noise, baby. Beatbox.
Shut your fucking pie
hole. Say, where you going?
And now back to DJ Strip. Pull your pants down for DJ Strip.
Tidbit about this track, my man Mark Kamen is one of my mentors. Put it together, man. Mark Kamen, the man who made Madonna famous, so blame him.
Turn off that DJ Strip.
Don't you dare if you know what's good for you.
DJ Strip to the house. Hey, where you going? DJ Strip to the house.
Don't turn that dial. Now back to DJ Strip.
That's right, baby. We're back. We're back. The beatbox, baby. Auto noise. You know, that was part of the Breakin' soundtrack. You remember Breakin'? That was pretty cheesy, but fun nonetheless. You know, it was a cool movie. I had a couple friends, actually, because when I started out as a DJ out on Strong Island, I was DJing for a bunch of cats called the Circle Breakers. They were an amazing breakdance crew. My man Guy Giovia, I know he's listening out there. Steve Wu, who is like the most amazing Chinese breakdancer. He was in Breakin'. You know, it was just a wild time back then. You could just be some street dancer in Washington Square Park one day, and the next thing you know it, you up in a movie. It was beautiful. It was beautiful. But I tell you, I want to drop this other track. You know usually I do a little talking in between and a little bullshitting and maybe take a call or whatever, or have my man Quagmire say something.
Oh, I got a package for you too. Oh,
right. That's right. He's got a package. I don't know what kind of package he's talking about, but with Quagmire, anything goes. But like I said, that's one of my favorite tracks. Art of Noise, Beatbox. I remember there was a great club called Private Eyes, and my man Mark Kamens used to spin there, and they were ahead of their time. Now, there was Spies on Long Island. That was a video dance club, but they just had these two CRT projectors. You remember the old red, green, blue light bulb, big-ass projectors? Well, he used to have... Oh, wait, someone's trying to call. This is nice. Everyone's calling. We're liking this. But anyway, so Spies had big video screens, but Private Eyes... They had the most incredible setup. They had a great setup. They had monitors. They had TVs of all different sizes. It was very cool. So, you know, that's why I was just saying that Mark Kamens, he was involved with producing that track, and he used to DJ there. And I want to try to drop this last track here from my laptop. No, I'm not a laptop DJ, but I forgot the CD that I was going to bring that I mastered. And this is just a classic. Again, going back to the rap thing that was kind of fresh starting out. There was some really goofy shit going on. Beastie Boys and a few other types that were kind of funny, corny, slash nerdy. But this cat is just amazing. And another track that actually crossed over pretty big to radio. One of my favorites of all time. So I'd like to drop this for you right about now. And we're talking about the one and only Brooklyn's own Bismarcky. You are listening to Newtown Radio, DJ Strip, the party you missed.
Let me tell you a story of my situation. I was talking to this girl from the U.S. nation. The way that I met her was on tour at a concert. She had long hair and a short miniskirt. I just got on stage dripping, pouring with sweat. I was walking through the crowd, and guess who I met? I whispered in her ear, come to the picture booth so I can ask you some questions to see if you're 100 proof. I asked her her name, she said blah, blah, blah. She had 9-10 pants and a very big bra. I took a couple of flicks since she was enthused. I said, how do you like the show? She said I was very amused. I started throwing bass, she started throwing back mid-range. But when I sprung the question, she acted kind of strange. Then when I asked, do you have a man? She tried to pretend. She said, no, I don't. I only have a friend. Come on, I'm not even going for it. This is what I'm going to say. You got what I need. But you say he just a friend. And you say he just a friend. Oh, baby, you got what I need. But you say he just a friend. But you say he just a friend. Oh, baby, you got what I need. But you say he just a friend. But you say he just a friend.
So I took Blah Blah's word for it. This time I thought just having a friend couldn't be no crime. Cause I have friends and that's a fact. Like Agnes, Agatha, Jermaine, and Jack. Forget about that, let's go into the story about a girl named blah 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 that adore me. So we started talking, getting familiar, spending a lot of time so we can build a relationship or some understanding how it's gonna be in the future we was planning. Everything sounded so dandy and sweet. I had no idea I was in for a treat. After this was established, everything was cool. The tour was over and she went back to school. I called every day to see how she would do and every time that I call her, it seemed something was brewing. I called the room, a guy picked up, and then I called again. I said, yo, who is that? Oh, he's just a friend. Don't give me that. Don't even give me that. You bust this. You got what I need. But you say he's just a friend. And you say he's just a friend. Oh, baby, you got what I need. But you say he's just a friend. But you say he's just a friend. Oh, baby, you got what I need. But you say he's just a friend. But you say he's just a friend. So I came to her college on a surprise visit to see my girl that was so exquisite. It was a school day. I know she was there the first semester of the school year. I went to a gate to ask where was a dorm. This guy made me fill out a visitor's form. He told me where it was, and I was on my way to see my baby doll, I was happy to say. I arrived in front of the dormitory. Yo, could you tell me where is door 3? They showed me where it was for the moment. I didn't know I was in for such an event. So I came to a room and opened the door. Oh, snap! Guess what I saw? I felt a tongue kissing my girl in the mouth. I was so in shock, my heart went down south. So please listen to the message that I sent. Don't ever talk to a girl who says she just has a friend. Has a friend. Has a friend. Has a friend. Has a friend.
Get your fucking pile.
Say, where you going?
And now back to DJ Strip.
That's right, baby. We're back. We're back live. We're just getting a party up in this place. I don't know what's going on. Miguel's just bringing him in off the street. I don't know what's going on, Miguel, but I like it. I like it a lot. Who we got in here? Let's make some. Can we have a little noise so people hear a little applause? Yeah. See. I wasn't bullshitting you. There's actually people here. You know, I know it's New York City, but some people actually do get up before 6 o'clock, you know, at night on a Saturday. You know, they're not all out doing drugs and partying. You know, some people actually do have a social life in the daytime. I try. I'm more of a summer socializer. You know, I like to do the little Central Park skate thing. Another one of my venues where I spin in the summertime. But, you know, it's nice. We got a whole bunch of people. This is, you know, again, I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in to my first show here at Newtown Radio. I'd like to thank my man Tariq. He's my man there, you know. He's a big presence. Very quiet young guy, though. Look, she's got it all. We got some people here. I think. Now, what's going on, Tariq? She's getting a show. What's going on? Is that what's going on? What's your name again?
Sherry Barkley.
Sherry Barkley. That's a very nice name. And what's your show going to be about, Sherry? That's a pretty popular topic these days with the kids. I know. I get that every time I ask a kid something. So what's your name? ADD. See, it's a young person's thing. See? It's good, though. Is the show called what? ADD? All you need is what? Come on, here you go.
You heard me say, but really, it was going to be like,
Oh, it's a meditation show for people with ADD. That makes sense. See? It's everywhere. And it's not a bad thing. You know, that's how the world makes money, prescription drugs, right? I mean, let's face it. That's what the war on drugs was all about. It was just so, you know, the Colombians stopped making the money and the Pfizers of the world make all the money. I mean, Adderall is cocaine. I got news for you, kids. That's pretty much what it is. So keep giving your gift Coke. You know, give your kids Coke. Make sure you balance it out with a little weed. That might do the trick when you want them to come down. I don't know. I don't have kids, thank God. So, you know, I have chihuahuas. You know, they're perfect kids. You know, they shit very little. I don't have to, you know, it's awesome. You know, they don't eat much. Actually, I was going to bring Poppy, but, you know, next time. I got to ease it in. I don't want to overwhelm anyone with my madness. But, you know, my madness is music. And I tell you, back out, though, to my man Philippe, again, I spoke of earlier. He owned this great club on Long Island back in the day called Paris, New York. It was one of the hottest punk/new wave clubs. I was in a gang at the time called the Champion Gene, and I was not very well liked in the club scene, at least by not the club owners. The girls liked me and people who did drugs because, I don't know, I guess I had drugs. And they just mysteriously appeared in my pocket, and people would give me money for it. It was the 80s, baby. But my man, again, Herbie, this is going out to you. This is going out to Popeye. This is going out to Kelly, Woody. You know you hate when I call you Woody, but I know you love this song, The Smiths. What else? Me, this charming man. Newtown Radio, the party you missed with DJ Strip. More applause, more applause.
Punctured bicycle on a hillside desolate. You let you make a man of me, yeah. When in this charming car, this charming man, why can't the life's complexity when the leather runs smooth on the passenger seat?
Your pants down for DJ Strip.
So you think you're a DJ.
To more DJ Strip, the DJ you don't have to be on three hits to enjoy.
That's right, baby. No drugs needed. No, no, no. Natural high. That's how we fly here, baby, in Bushwick. You know, I just realized, and I said I had some guests that have appeared, and it turns out I'm very fortunate. Princess Superstar is up in the house. All right. That's right. That's right. Round of applause. Round of applause. Let's go. Hey. All right. See, I kind of didn't recognize her because she's a little, you know, toned down and she looks a little pregnant. So, and I didn't want to, like, you know, suggest it. You know, God forbid, you know, I had a friend one time and there was a woman on the subway and he thought she was pregnant. So he thought he was doing the gentlemanly thing and he got up to give her the seat and it turned out she was just fat. And she looked at him like, what the fuck? Why are you offering me your seat? And realizing it, being as quick as he was, he said, because I'm a gentleman. And he, like, got off the train immediately because she was not very happy about it. But, hey, it's okay, you know? Listen, fat people, skinny people, we love you all as long as you enjoy good music. You know, stay away from that radio because that regular radio will definitely fry your brain with repetitive garbage. You know, you got to turn your kids on at a young age because if you let them get Disneyfied, it's over. There's just no going back. Once they get that Britney Spears in their system, I'm telling you, they'll be setting themselves up for a life of mediocrity and they'll just accept it. And, you know, I mean, for them, like Lady Gaga's Mozart, I mean, it's what it is. You know, I mean, that's highbrow, I guess, you know, in the world of music for these kids nowadays. Sorry, I needed a drink.
Again, big shout out to Curly listening in Hilsing in Germany. And if anyone knows where that is, then you're really from nowhere, because there's a lot of cows and a lot of land, actually. It's just north of Switzerland, where I had the pleasure of being last month, even though it was about 20 below zero. Had a great time. And I want to give a shout out to everyone, all my listeners in Germany. And I got some nice listeners in Japan tuning in. My man Philippe, like I spoke about earlier, I don't know. I think he's in Cozumel. So fuck you, because it's fucking cold here. And I wish you were in Siberia, but I still love you. And thank you for letting me in the club, even though all the other owners didn't want you to. But again, you know, that's just part of the history of New York City. You know, a lot of times, you know, now it's like it's a faceless nightclub. You know, a lot of times you go to a place that you don't meet the owner. You don't meet, you know, I mean, you're lucky you can even find a real manager or, you know, like another great example of a space that I was fortunate enough to work at and be a part of was a great club on 14th Street known as Nell's. And anybody who is familiar with Nell's, you know, they just know that if you could even get in the place, man, you were just, you know, you were on, and you'd have some really good times. And I had some amazing evenings there, and was very fortunate enough to be a part of that scene for a few years in the mid to late 80s. Again, though, you know, there are a few songs I will be playing. You know, I don't go too deep. I don't want to be one of those, you know, you get some of these internet radio people, and they're playing like cockroaches farting, and, you know, it's like, you know, I mean, that's all well and fine, but it's Saturday, you're home, it's cold, you know, you may be a little hungover, you may be, you know, maybe you didn't go out last night, maybe you have no fucking life at all, I don't know, but, you know, you could always reminisce the good times. And I have to tell you, this next song I'm going to play, I spoke earlier about Mark Kamens, one of the guys who actually influenced me as a DJ, and he had the pleasure or unpleasure of producing this next young lady. Well, she's not so young anymore, but her boyfriends get younger and younger every year. So that could be, well, and Mae West is dead, so we know it's not her. Could only be one other famous whore, and that would be, of course, my favorite whore, and I'm sure yours too. The not-so-lady Madonna with Get Into This Groove. You're listening to Newtown Radio, DJ Strip, the party you missed.
For inspiration. Come on.
Perfume, or you do smell like that always.
Dancing.
Get over here. You. Hot stuff. I got something for you to listen to.
We're back. We're in the groove, no doubt. Thank God not Madonna's. That could be a scary groove to be in, I'm sure. But hey, God bless you, Carlos, or whatever your Latin lover's name is this week, honey. Well, again, you know, let's not beat up on Lady Madonna, God forbid. But, you know, again, getting back to a couple other spots that I used to haunt, I want to talk about time's flying by. It's already 3:15. It's amazing. The show runs 2 to 4 every Saturday. Newtown Radio. If you want to call in and insult me, if you'd like, I don't mind. I don't have feelings. 347-725-4163. I'm an equal opportunity insulter. So if you can bring it, bring it. But just remember, it'll be my turn. You might not like it. So come correct. You know, just do the right thing. But getting back to like I was saying, I want to give a shout out to my man Pat. He used to have this great club in the mid-80s called Peggy Sue's. I had the pleasure of, there you go, you remember Peggy Sue's, I know you do. It was a great little spot above this Chinese joint, 13th and University. My man Pat, who owns a lot of other places, Naked Lunch, Gemini Lounge, you know, he's a classic Brooklyn Irishman, and he's just a wonderful cat, and had this great club. And my man used to DJ there, oh God, what was it, DJ Jazz, remember Jazz? No, not Jazzy Nice, DJ Jazz. Yeah, Jazzy Nice was a little Latin dude. DJ Jazz was a big black brother. And very nice, very sweet. And, you know, I used to love going there because Matt Dillon was one of the co-owners. That was Pat was smart. See, he was a classic Irishman from Brooklyn, you know, fireman family members, the whole thing, you know, and had some crazy but he always had, like, these celebrity partners, and he was smart. Because that's how, you know, you pull in all the hot girls. Because, like, you know, Matt's got the personality of a tick. So, you know, I mean, if you have his head looks like, I mean, it's like a giant watermelon. It's amazing. He's got the biggest head. But he's a good-looking guy. He's a talented cat. But, you know, he was smart. He would get these celebrity partners. And that way, you know, he really could just kick back and just be like an owner who just hung out. And, you know, listen, he was a good-looking guy. He was a big-time model. In the late 70s when the whole modeling thing just started blowing up. So he was smart. He invested his money in nightclubs, and to this day he's still going strong. So a big shout out to my man Pat. And I would definitely like to drop this track. And this is just something that my man was known for, Jazz. He was always on top of shit. And good times. Is that these guys were, you know, two cats that were on top of the hip-hop dance thing long before anybody knew what was going to happen with it, and they stayed with it. I actually recently did an event with one of them, along with Melly Mel from Grandmaster Flash, who performed at my man Matt DeMatt's birthday party at the this crazy new like $10 million bowling alley on 42nd and 12th. But, of course, you know, none other than Mr. Eric B. and Rakim. You know you got it.
Just talk about that.
soul, that is.
It's been a long time. I shouldn't have left you without a strong rhyme to step to. Think of how many weeks shows you slept through. Time's up. I'm sorry I kept you. Thinking of this, you keep repeating your miss. The rhyme from the microphone solo with. So you sit by the radio and on the dial soon. As you hear it, pump up the volume. Dance with the speaker till you hear it blow. Then plug in a headphone, cause here it go. It's a four-letter word when it's heard to control your body to dance. So, dot text a tempo like a red alert. Reach your reflex and let it work. When this is playing, you can't get stuck with the steps. So can say, and I'ma still come up with a gift to be swift. Follow the leader, the rhyme will go deaf with the record that was mixed a long time ago. It could be done, but only I could do it. For those that could dance and clap your hands to it. I start to think, and then I sink into the paper like I was ink. When I'm writing, I'm trapped in between the line. I escape when I finish the rhyme. I got soul, soul, soul. Stage is empty. A beat like this might tempt me to pose, show my rings in my fat gold chain. Grab the mic like I'm on Soul Train, but I wait, cause I master this. Let the others go first so the brothers don't miss. Eric B, break the sticks.
You got it.
Rock him will begin when you make the mix. I'll experiment like a scientist. You wanna rhyme? You gotta sign my list. Cause I'ma manifest and bless the mic I'll hold. You want an X? Then you gotta have soul. Cause if you ain't got it, I'ma make an encore. Take the mic, make the people respond for the R. Cause that's the way it'll have to be. If you wanna get on after me, think about it. Wait, erase your rhyme. Forget it, and don't waste your time. Cause I'll be in the crowd if you ain't controlling it. Drop the mic, you shouldn't be holding it. This is how it should be done. This style is identical to none. Some try to make it sound like this, but you're getting me. So upset that I'm wet cause you're sweating me. I drip steam
it
like
comes
a microphone
in there, and I look at Tom Rick J.
Is my
right. He comes in there and I said, look at Tom Rick J. Bitch, come over here and have sex with Charlie Murphy. I'm Rick James, bitch.
Say my name. First of all, I'm the soloist, the soul controller. Rock him, get stronger as I get older. Constant elevation, cause expansion. I write my rhymes while I cool in my
get
mansion.
Your fucking bio.
Say, where you going?
And now back to DJ Strip.
That's right. We are back, baby. Back live in DeWick. Newtown Radio, kid. Eric B. and Rakim. They got the soul. Hopefully they still got the dough, because I know Eric had a little problemo with the Colombian ski powder. But hey, you know, everybody goes down a path and, you know, you find your way back. And if you don't, God bless you, man. You
what?
Know. What?
What?
Oh, shit.
What?
What happened?
What? What?
Oh, man. What happened there? Dave Chappelle showed up. I don't know how the hell that happened. But actually, you know, that's another cool cat I knew in the 80s back in Washington Square Park days. He was, you know, coming up as a comedian when my man Charlie Barnett, not too many people familiar with Charlie Barnett, but he was an amazing comedian from the 80s. He was in the movie DC Cab, if you remember. And let's see, he was on Miami Vice. Tell you a funny story, though, about him. He was actually the funniest guy I've ever heard in my life. And he was actually offered the role on Saturday Night Live. This is pre-Eddie Murphy. And he was all ready to have it. They were giving it to him. Eddie Murphy was out of the running. He didn't have a chance. Listen, Eddie Murphy's a funny guy. Don't get me wrong. But if you knew Charlie Murphy. See, I'm caught up now with Charlie Murphy. If you knew, it's of course Eddie's brother. If you knew, all right, this guy, Charlie Barnett, forget it. He was the funniest cat. So what happened is they offered him the gig at Saturday Night Live. Unfortunately, he couldn't keep it, and the reason was that nobody knew this at the time, but Charlie couldn't read. So that was a little problem, because all you do is read cue cards on Saturday Night Live. And that's how Eddie Murphy got his start on Saturday Night Live. So there's a little bit of Eddie Murphy, Charlie Barnett,
trivia. A lot of people don't know that. I mean, I'm sure Eddie Murphy would have still, you know, done his thing and made it and moved on to be the uber star he is. I don't know. He does all these crazy, boring kid movies now. But, hey, God bless him, you know. He's getting paid. He's getting all kinds of hot girls, having kids with Spice Girls. I don't know. God bless you, Eddie Murphy. But Charlie Barnett was the man, and he was just, you know, a great guy, funny comedian. And, you know, but like I said, you know, life goes on, life goes on. Music is permanent. It's eternal. It's something we all enjoy. And I want to talk about this crazy motherfucker, talking about Rick James, because, you know, he was just, you know, a crazy bastard.
He comes in there and I said, look, bitch, I'm Rick James. Smack him.
Like I said, you know, Rick James, man, he was a character. I used to go up to this club uptown that my friend used to DJ at. I'll never forget, they opened up in late 86, early 87. It was called the China Club. And there you go, China Club in the house. That was a crazy club. And a lot of Wildcats used to hang out there. My man Hex Hector was the main DJ there, a real good friend of mine. He's moved on. He's an amazing remixer, producer. But I'll never forget, I was invited to go to a party there for the owner, Danny Freed, and let's see, Vitas Gerulaitis and Mick Jagger. It was their birthday party. So we get up in the spot, and, you know, we're all excited because, you know, I'm like 21 years old. I got no business being up in there with all these famous folks. And it turned out to be quite an amazing evening because, you know, I had the pleasure of meeting this crazy bastard, you know, who was always...
Bitch, come over here and have sex with Charlie Murphy.
That's right.
Rick James, bitch.
None other. Rick James. Yo, this guy was insane. I mean, to the 10th degree. And my friend, he was in a band who was the house band at the time, a China Club. So, of course, you know, we'd all be in the back little room they had to get set up. And this guy, party animal. I mean, if you hung around this guy, you were definitely headed to Betty Ford and or the grave for that matter. But I love you, Rick James. One of my all-time favorite tracks. And they used to always drop this, of course, when he'd come up in it. Not the typical Rick James track, but then again, I'm just not the typical DJ. You're listening to Newtown Radio, DJ Strip, the party you missed.
Bitch, come over here and have sex with Charlie Murphy. I'm Rick James, bitch.
Where's
the foul fingers? Say the face!
What?
Stop!
You wouldn't make love to me. You went fast asleep.
I'm Rick James,
you wouldn't even
bitch.
Talk to me. You say I'm so crazy.
I'm one of the baddest motherfuckers of all time. One of the best singers, one of the best looking motherfuckers you've ever seen. Hold my breath,
I just wanna love you.
I just wanna love you.
I'm one of the baddest motherfuckers of all time. One of the best singers, one of the best looking motherfuckers you've ever seen. Hold my drink, bitch.
That stuff, that funk, that sweet, that funky stuff.
Give it to me, give it to me. Give it to me, give it to me. Give it to funk, that sweet, funky stuff.
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
Give it to me. Darkness, everybody, dark, everyone. Darkness is spreading.
Drug
up, be merry. What?
How can I love you,
baby?
funk is stuck. Give it to me. Give me that stuff, that funk, that sweet, that funk is stuck. Give it to me, give it to me. Give it to me, give it to me. Give me your stuff, that sweet funk is stuck.
And now back to DJ Strip.
Ooh, we got a little microphone. There we go. We're back. Yeah, we got a little XLR issue over here, but we'll be all right. I'll try not to move around too much. It's almost impossible for me, I know. I'm always moving. Moving and shaking. Rick James, baby. You know Rick. Rick was the man. If you ever spent any time around that guy, you were happy to get away from him at the end. Trust me. He was quite the madman. You know, I'm really digging this. I'm enjoying. I'm glad everyone's out there listening. I got a nice group of people here. A little plethora going on. The plethora. Can I hear the plethora? A little applause. Hey, see? Oh, it's a beautiful, beautiful Saturday here in DeWick. You know, look, there's more white. I've never seen so many white people in Bushwick. It's unbelievable. I think it's time for me to move to Red Hook. I don't know. I got to. Canarsie, maybe. I don't know. Where's the real black areas, Tariq? Oh, he doesn't know. This guy's more white than me. Please. Jesus. Definitely has a better vocabulary, no doubt. But, no, it's all good. It's all good. We love Mr. Tariq, and I'm loving everyone out there listening. Oh, yeah, I'm definitely having a little. If I hold this, yeah, there we go. I'll be fine. But, you know, again, getting back to the music, like I said, I love the fact the 80s was, you know, you could be anywhere. You could be all over the place. You could be a punk rocker one day. You could be a new waver the next. You could be a disco head if you wanted. There was still some disco clubs going on. You know, but for me at that time, I would say early to mid 80s, I was definitely more involved with the new wave kind of punk scene. There was a lot of cool spots in New York. But Long Island definitely had it going on. People that have no idea, like I said, Spies in Farmingdale, Paris, New York, and Huntington, Thrush, I believe was in Rockville Center. You had Spanky's, which was a great venue Sunday nights, and I believe that was in Lake Grove. So there was places all over the island, and you could see a lot of great concerts and a lot of great shows. And I remember seeing this next group. They were phenomenal. I saw them, I believe, and they came to this place called Record Stop. And Record Stop was the cool place to go get your vinyl. A lot of import stuff from Europe that you couldn't get, you know, at TSS or any of the other joints. You know, you remember. Come on. That's right. That's where we used to get our vinyl back, you know. But, you know, of course, if you wanted the nice European import stuff, the Depeche Mode, you know, certain groups. You had to go to Record Stop. And one day I happened upon Record Stop with my friend Tommy, and they had an album signing there in this group, and they were actually performing at Stony Brook College. So we said, hey, you know, how can we get to the show? We kind of started bullshitting with the guys. I think I pulled out a joint, got them high, and before you knew it, they put us on the guest list. So, you know, one of the last tracks I'll be throwing out there and one of my all-time favorites. Again, more of a B-side for this group, but nonetheless, if you're a fan, you'll dig it just like I do. It's the Violent Femmes with Added Up. Newtown Radio, baby. DJ Strip, the party you missed.
I need someone, a person to talk to, someone who care to love. Could it be you? Could it be you? Situation gets rough, then I start to panic. It's not enough, it's just the habit. A kid, you're sick. Well, darling, this is it.
See, that's why he's in it.
You can all just kiss off into the air. Behind my back, I can see them stare. They'll hurt me bad, but I won't mind. They'll hurt me bad, they do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
you're permanent. Oh yeah? Well, don't get so distressed. Did I happen to mention that I'm impressed?
You knew what went on at that cab stand, and every once in a while I'd have to take a beating. But by then I didn't care. The way I saw it, everybody takes a beating sometimes.
Three for my heartache and four.
Now take me to jail.
Headaches and five for my lonely and six.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
Seven, no tomorrow and eight.
Now take me to jail.
I forget what eight was for, but nine. Kiss off into the air. Behind my back I can see them stare. They'll hurt me bad, but I won't mind. They'll hurt me bad, they do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they do it all the time.
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 Do it all the time. Time, 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 time.
And now, back to more DJ Strick. The DJ you don't have to be on three hits to enjoy.
But I'm sure it might make it even more pleasurable. I wouldn't know. I don't do that stuff. I try to stick to the naturals, you know, the Mary Jane. Maybe a little Jack and Coke. You know. Oh, man, I'm really enjoying this, though. This is awesome. Getting near the end of my show. I just saw who just came in. She's got a great 80s show rolling up next. You want to come say hi? Come over here. Give me some love.
Hi, I forgot about you. Hey.
Say hi.
I missed the party.
Come on. The party.
I missed the whole party.
I told you the party was in my mouth and everyone was coming. She not even likes my dirty stuff. See? 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 It's my plethora. That's my plethora. Hefe, do you know what a plethora is? Three Amigos, my all-time favorite movie, 1987. That's the year that we're talking about. You know what I mean? That's what it's all about. 1987, an amazing year, a horrible year. Let's see. You know, I mean, if you listen to the radio in 87, it was I Want to Dance with Somebody, Whitney Houston, Billy Vera and the Beaters. Oh, man, it was brutal. Brutal stuff. I mean, it was like depressing stuff. It was really sad. It was bad. I mean, Whitney was cute with her like straight look and her crazy hair. But, you know, that was way before Bobby Brown and the crack. So, you know, but hey, you know, she still got the money and that's all that matters. And we love her. She'll probably never sound the same, though, because crack is definitely not good for the vocal cords. I don't recommend it. So stay away from the crack, kids, if you want to sing pretty. You know, but you're all on prescripts. You know, you don't know what crack is. You wouldn't know how to light a pipe. You know, you just, you're popping them down. You know, when I was a kid, it was Flintstones. You guys are, you know, you guys, I don't even know what you're taking, but it's a scary fucking world. You know, people wonder why, you know, their kids are coming out like three-eyed and two-toed and, you know, half a brain cell. Gee, it might have been all that coke you were doing with me in 87 at the World. I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. But I have a lot of friends, though, from back then that are, like, married and respectful and have kids, and they should not be surprised when their kid can't, you know, count to three, you know. You know, I mean, it was just a lot of chemicals going on. And I don't think that stuff really leaves your body as quickly as you might want it to. You know, but hey, you know, it's just life. It's life as we know it. Remember, you reap what you sow. So you guys are going to have the craziest kid. You understand? Do you understand? No, actually,
maybe it'll be like one of those, you know, two negatives make a positive. Not that you're negatives, but I'm just saying, you know, it could be. Oh, wait, she's coming in now. Come on in.
Coming in. Well, I think is that probably the kid will be like super straight because we're so crazy.
That's what I mean. That's exactly what I mean. Because my parents were like the bookends of boring, you know, and I was the crazy in the middle. So I don't know. It's possible. I don't know. You, I'm a little worried about. She seems like a little more with it. We'll see. How far along are we?
6 months.
6 months. You. Do you know how long I know this guy?
I know.
I haven't seen you in at least what? This is my friend Miguel who's here. We go way back, man. Like, we were victims of the 80s and the 90s. Still here, though, brother. Slap! Yeah, well, I'm glad. It's nice to have people here. I thought it was just going to be, you know, me and Tariq swords fighting each other, you know, like 8-year-old boys in the shower. But and if you have a boy, trust me, they'll do that. So just let him have fun. Hey, listen, if he can hold it in his hand and you can still see it, he's ahead of the game, okay? So that's a good sign, you know. It means he's well endowed, and that's not a bad thing to be these days. But they also have pills for that. See, that's the kind of world we live in. See, in 1987, there was no penis grow pill, okay? I mean, and everyone was on coke, so there was really not a lot of penis going on at all. I'm amazed anybody got pregnant in the 80s because, you know, cocaine is definitely not a man's best friend. But, getting back to the music, to the fun, to the people. You know, I'm getting to the end. How much I got, Tariq? Ooh, 18 minutes. That's not bad. I could probably get in at least, you know, one or two more tracks. And again, I'd like to just, you know, mix it up again. Like I said, musically, I was all over the place. I remember there was a great spot that I used to go to, another little haunt of mine. And it was just this little down, out-of-the-way place. A lot of people might not remember it. You know, it was weird because this place, like, you know, a lot of clubs now, they only play one style of music or they're known for a certain style of music. And this was just a really cool spot that I used to go to with a friend of mine. And I don't know why we went there, but one night we stumbled upon it. It was like a cool place to go to before you would go to the tunnel because the tunnel was the hot new club. So what we would do is we'd go to this joint, and it was on the east side. It's now called City Crab for all you newbies in New York, and it's like this really atrocious crab joint. But I don't know. They're busy, so people must like really bad crabs. As compared to good crabs, I don't know. Is there such a thing? Crabs? Anyone? No? Good. We're all clean or just well-shaved. I don't know. It's you know, just the way it is. But this place was really cool. It was a great place. It was called Cafe Iguana. See? Miguel remembers. And it was fun because, like, you could go there on any given night and Leon from Fame would be up on the bar dancing and, you know, just all this random cast of characters. My friend Malik Yoba, who was in City Kids, who is an actor now, does a lot of those Janet Jackson movies, and that black dude who I think is gay. I'm not sure what his name is, but he does all them Mama movies and all that stuff. But so there'd be a lot of cool people hanging out there. And, you know, that was what was great about the music then. And at that time, this group was huge. They'd come out in the early 80s, but they really blew up with this album, this track. And I'd like to drop it because it's one of my favorites. And unfortunately, Mr. Hutchins is no longer involved in the world of the living. I don't know what he's doing. I'm sure he's having a good time because he had way too good of a time while he was alive. It's New Sensation. In Excess, baby.
your fucking pie hole.
Say, where you going?
And now back to DJ Strip.
That's right, baby. We're back. We're back. We got a live room up in here. Everything's going on.
That was strangely arousing.
That's right, Quagmire. Very arousing. Yeah? Quagmire gets off on everything. Well, let me tell you, I've had a great, 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 great time with my show. My first show, I'm very happy. Didn't have too many technical difficulties. I've been getting a lot of emails, a lot of texts from people that, let's see what we got here. That's the beauty of modern technology. Liliana, best song ever. Well, you're the best, baby. Don't go changing. Try to please me. Yeah. Let's see, my man Robert, shout out. Thanks for the shout out to Nels. You got it, brother. Yeah, I know you were up in that spot. That was, whoo, Nels. Man, let me tell you a great story about Nels. I'll never forget. When it first opened, it was one of the hardest clubs to get into. And I remember I met this beautiful Israeli model, and she was real uppity and snobby and thought she was all that. So she acted like she was doing me a favor. So she says, listen, I can get you into Nels, but, you know, if I meet another person, you know, don't be offended, blah, blah, blah. In other words, if she was going to upgrade me, I should just be okay with it. I didn't have a problem with it because I was getting in Nels. I didn't care. Well, I get up in Nels. And my friend's band, Communication in Babylon, is the house band. My man Rick Sheridan, my man Gary Jourdain, who's on CSI. Well, he was the singer. It was amazing. So they're playing upstairs, and all of a sudden I meet this beautiful Korean girl, and we start dancing, and it turns out she's Grace Jones' stylist. So she says, listen, I'm here with Grace Jones and Dolph Lundgren and all these people. Why don't you come back to my table? That's right, Dolph Lundgren. He still looks good. Let me tell you, he looks good. Do you see him in that new movie, Sylvester Stallone? What was it, The Untouchables? Oh, no, that's India. Wait. But anyway, Dolph Lundgren, right? So all of a sudden, you know, the Israeli girl that I came in, she's off with some other guy. I don't know what she's doing. So I'm like, yeah, fuck it. So I go off with this girl. Her name was Grace. Shout out to Grace. Big, beautiful, plus-size Korean model girl. She was amazing. And so all of a sudden, I walk up to the table, and who's sitting at the table? Grace Jones, Dolph Lundgren, because, you know, they have a kid together. That kid must be freaky looking. So, you know, I walk over. Now, who else is there? Nick Nolte. Because he's shooting this movie called Q&A with Timothy Hutton. So Chris Penn, Sean Penn's brother. So I'm like, yo, this is the shit. So now I'm hanging out with all these cool-ass celebs, right? Blah, blah, blah. I don't care about this Israeli girl. She can't even get into the area now where I'm hanging out. Fuck her. So all of a sudden, my man's band starts playing. And he goes, yo, stick around because there's a special guest here. You're not going to believe it. And how could this night get any better? Well, sure enough, it did. So I look over at the stage, and he's looking at me. He's like, yo, check this out. And I'm like, what's going on? So they start playing, and I'm thinking, okay, they're playing their music, blah, 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 boring. You know, I mean, they were all right, band and everything, but they weren't, you know, they weren't going anywhere. But nonetheless, all of a sudden, who gets up on stage? None other than himself, the purple little bastard from Minneapolis, Prince. And he fucking blows the place away. Couldn't get any better than that. Now the funniest part was now the Israeli girl's pissed off at me because I'm having like A-list time. I'm having a great time. She can't even get up past the bar. So she's all pissed off at me. So I'm standing there making out with the Korean girl, and all of a sudden, boom, 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 she taps me on my shoulder. She says, listen, you're coming home with me. You took me here. You got to bring me home. So I'm like, fuck, I want to hang out with cool people. So I said to her, listen, baby, I'll be right back. So I leave Nels, jump in a cab. We're heading back. She's yelling, what, do you think you're going to stick your tongue in my mouth now? Or no. You think you're going to stick your dick in my pussy after you stuck your tongue in that girl's mouth? And I'm like, all right, listen, baby, let's just go home. Let's end it. Thank God I lived around the block. So she gets out of the cab. She's like, you coming up? I said, no, I'm going to go home. The cab driver looks at me like, oh, you fucked up, huh, guy? I'm like, yeah, I fucked up. Take me back to Nels, asshole. So I get back to Nels, but now it's impossible to get back inside because it's like just deep, mobbed. So I'm like, ah, fuck it. I'm not going to get back in. All of a sudden, the door opens up. Boom. Here comes Dolph Lundgren, Grace Jones. They're getting in the limo. My girl Grace, she grabs my arm, pulls me in the car, and we partied at Grace's house for like 3 days. It was awesome. So big up to my girl in Israel, Tova. Fuck you.
I love you, though. You got me into Nels. And actually was a catalyst for me becoming a DJ, because then I kind of hooked up with the people who ran Nels, Nell herself, who was amazing. And that kind of was a catalyst for me to get involved with that whole scene. But you know what? We're getting near the end of my show, and I've really enjoyed the time here, and I really appreciate the opportunity. And I hope my people out there listening have enjoyed my madness and my music, because it's all kind of, you know... Thank you. It was a little applause. I thought I had a little applause. Oh, hey, oh! I'm such a whore. I admit it. I'm like a fucking seal. I'll do anything for claps. But no, it's all good, baby. I'm really happy to be a part of this, and I hope everyone will tune in on a weekly, every Saturday, 2 to 4, the party you missed with DJ Strip. And I think I'm going to drop it out now, and this might not be to most people what they would think of, you know, a classic 80s song in a sense, but it really was. Now, I used to go to this place with my friend Perry, I told you about before, the handsome black brother, and there was this really hot black club, and it was called Bentley's. Now, not too many people are familiar with that, and it was like a roller club. Like, Mike Tyson would be up in his shit, Bobby Brown. It was a crack fest. I mean, it was crazy. But everybody was dressed in their nice Armani suits, and, you know, so you had to look right, you had to look tight. And but this was a great track that I remember one of the DJs there always playing, and it's going to be one of my last tracks for the day. So I hope you enjoyed it as much as I have. It is Unlimited Touch, baby, because I hear music in the street.
Dang.
Oh, no, that's not it. Oh, we fucked up. There it is. Hey, you know I had to fuck up at least once, right, Tariq? Come on. At least one time, at least at the end of the show. But again, you're listening to DJ Strip, Newtown Radio, the party you missed. In the street, baby.
Pull your pants down for DJ Strip.
I am too high.
hold the hammer in hand.
Park their Cadillac. I mean, here I am, this little kid. I can't even see over the steering wheel, and I'm parking Cadillac.
What do you want, fucko? You want some? Huh? What do you want, fucko? You want some? Huh? What do you want, fucko? You want some? Huh?
You took your first piece like a man, and you learned the two
Why
greatest things
pull up and Tootie would toss me their keys and let me park their Cadillac. Here I am, this little kid. I can't even see over the steering wheel, and I'm parking Cadillac.
Hey, man, you ever hear a DJ Strip?
That's all right. Not everybody might have heard of me. I'm not exactly a household DJ, but I had a great time today, and hopefully now you know who I am and what I'm all about, and tune in every Saturday. What's that? 5 seconds. Love you. Ciao, baby.